Welcome to the Copeland Coaching Podcast, where it's all about turning your job search into a slam dunk. Your host is Angela Copeland.
Welcome to the Copeland Coaching Podcast. I'm your host, Angela Copeland. On the phone with me today, I have Dr. David Burkus in Tulsa, Oklahoma. David is an author, speaker, and associate professor of leadership and innovation at Oral Roberts University. His new book, Friend of a Friend, offers readers a new perspective on how to grow their networks and build key connections. He also gave a TEDx talk titled, Why You Should Know How Much Your Coworkers Get Paid. David, thank you for joining me today.
Oh, thank you so much for having me.
Well, I'm excited, first of all, that you're in Oklahoma. We talked about that. You're not too far away from where I grew up, and you're doing so many exciting things. So I'm really excited to get your perspective today.
Yeah, no, I'm excited to chat with you. And a former Okie, or I guess you're once an Okie, always an Okie. So there you go.
That's right. I'm a sixth generation Oklahoman, so I don't think I can get away from it. Well, so the first thing I want to touch on is pay transparency. Your TEDx talked about it, and I think the idea of pay transparency is a new one for a lot of us. So I'm curious, help me to understand, what does pay transparency look like in the corporate sort of work setting?
Yeah, so I mean, transparency takes its shape in a lot of different ways. And really, what's interesting is the research on this really predates the practice. So when I say pay transparency, the most common thing is, okay, everybody in a company knows what everybody gets paid. But that's really sort of the far end of the continuum. The truth is, I think I would call an organization pay transparent if it's just transparent in how we set the salaries. What is our formula, or what's the banding and the tiers, that type of thing. Those are sort of mid-range levels of transparency that you still see a lot of improvement on compared to the norm, at least the norm in the United States, which is, you're not supposed to talk about that, and you negotiate back and forth when you get hired, and then you really can't talk about it after that with other people, so you don't know if you did a good job negotiating or not. And it's really kind of a system that is what's weird is the discouragement against sharing your salaries comes from a fear that there'll be all sorts of chaos, and it's the secrecy that actually causes that chaos, not the transparency. And so when I was researching my previous book, Under New Management, this was one of the practices that we started to see. The research on it, we can dive into that a little bit later, actually predates the practice, but it's been encouraging to see an uptick in the private sector of pay transparent companies.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you mentioned that it's very cultural, I guess, in the U.S. that we don't talk about pay. Are there other places where it's a little bit more normal?
Yeah, so I mean, it depends on history and that sort of stuff. I've yet to see a lot of good research showing sort of cultural dimensions, like if you think about Hofstede's cultural dimensions from, you know, old school. But what we do see is in certain countries, it's far more prominent. So in a lot of Scandinavian countries, for example, it is everybody knows what everybody gets paid, right? Including in, I believe, Sweden, where you can kind of look up everybody in the country, not just in your company, right? And then you have in Iceland, for example, there are laws on the books that prevent gender discrimination in such a way that they require companies to be transparent with the government on how they're setting salaries, et cetera. And even in the United States, we used to be a little bit more transparent company. So when the income tax was actually first adopted across the nation, the registers of who paid what were kept at the county courthouse, and you could go look it up. And they did that as a tool of enforcement. The idea being, if you are looking, your neighbor's doing really well, and you're wondering, gee, I wonder, you know, what are they getting? You go and look it up, and then if it's clear they're not paying the appropriate taxes, you can help sort of tattle. Ooh. And keep it all enforced, right? So this is something that even in the United States used to be a much more sort of open thing, but has since become far more secret. And it's interesting to see the pendulum swinging back the other way, where there's cries for transparency coming in a variety of places.
Uh-huh. Absolutely. Well, you know, I think as you think about pay transparency, it probably also brings up sort of the pay gap and sort of whether or not it's there. And I've seen a couple of studies recently that talk about the fact that there are a number of sort of external factors that can explain away quite a lot of the pay gap. I wonder, in situations where pay transparency is more, where pay transparency is happening, do you think, and maybe this is a little too detailed, but do you think that it reduces that gap when we have more pay transparency?
Yeah. So, I mean, I'm going to have to get a little nerdy economist.
Oh, I would love that.
It definitely does. The statistic that I use often, including the one I use in the TEDx talk, is that when you look at without controlling for any factors, et cetera, which is what economists sort of are always doing to try and get the right number, you have that 77 cents on the dollar number, right? Median salary for females in the workforce versus median salary for males. And then if you look across, the best comparison, because of the sheer size of how many people they employ and all of that, is actually the federal government, where it's really mid-range transparency. Salaries are fixed to certain tiers, G1, G2, G3, et cetera. And then everybody knows what G level everybody is. So you basically, you have to do two steps, two short little mental leaps, but you can figure out anybody's salary inside the federal government. And there it shrinks from 23% to 11%. Mm. Now, to get nerdy economist, that is purely uncontrolled. So one of the first things that happened was I got angry emails from lots of people saying, well, it's not really 77 cents on the dollar, et cetera. And it's a moot point, right? So that's the uncontrolled. If you control every single thing that economists say you should control for, which every economist is different on what factors you should control for, you still get to 94 cents mm-hmm. on the dollar. So there is still a gap, even if you're controlling for stuff. And unfortunately, I don't have data on controlling for all of those factors, what it would be at a full salary transparent company. But it's, if you look uncontrolled, the evidence is really, really compelling.
Yeah.
And the other thing that you see is sort of anecdotally, a lot of companies that move towards transparency find problems internally with their own gender wage gap that they now have to fix, because you can't just sweep it under the rug. You're transparent. You have to fix it.
Wow, that's a really good point. Well, so you mentioned mostly a lot of pros. I guess that would be a con in terms of, well, I mean, it's not exactly a con, but from a company perspective, they've got to deal with a problem. Are there other cons to pay transparency, or do you see it mostly being a positive thing?
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to say that it's purely Pollyanna, right? I get it. It's uncomfortable. When I started researching this, I was kind of like, well, that's sort of weird. I don't know if I'd want everybody to know what I get paid.
Mm-hmm.
So it makes people uncomfortable. And in fact, even in some companies that I researched for the book, probably the most famous being SumAll, which is a company I'm a huge fan of. They are, everybody knows what everybody's salary is, and everybody knows how it's calculated. But one of the things that they did is anytime there was a new hire, in the announcement of here's this person and what she'll be doing or he'll be doing, and here's their salary, and employees actually came back and asked, you know, we know we can go into the company intranet and look it up. You don't really need to broadcast it, because what happens is not the employee that's getting hired, but all of the other employees are like, well, then I feel like I've got to really dig deep into this person's history and decide, was this worth it, et cetera. And I'd rather not know. And what you find is that in these transparent companies, a lot of times it's a big deal for employees for the first couple of months. It's a big deal for a new employee for the first couple of months. And then it's no big deal. It's just how we do things. So that initial tension of making the switch is definitely, I would call it a con, but it's a con that kind of takes care of itself over time.
Yeah, that's interesting. Well, so I'm curious, as you mentioned, sort of preparing for your TEDx talk, like what inspired you to really explore this topic in general? I mean, were you working on it for the courses that you teach, or was there something else that sort of inspired you to think about this pay transparency issue?
So we came across this, I mean, as a professor, so my background's in organizational psychology, and there's a series of studies in a motivational theory called equity theory that basically says that humans will, inside of an organization, will compare how hard they're working to how hard their peers are working, and then what their peers get paid, or whatever rewards their peers are getting to theirs. And if they feel like there's a disconnect, then they start to be demotivated, right? Now, the interesting thing about this is it doesn't say that everybody has to be equal. It just has to say that there has to be equity, meaning, you know, if I'm putting in, you know, 100 hours and you're putting in 40 hours, then we should probably have different rewards. But I'm okay with the idea that if I'm putting in 40 hours and you're putting in, you know, 60, 80, 100 hours, you getting paid more. I get that, right? It's just if there's the same rewards for different levels of work or different rewards for the same levels of work, that there begins to be a problem. And, you know, equity theory doesn't come out and say it, but the problem is that a lot of times in a secrecy condition, we're really bad at judging what other people get paid. We're really bad at knowing how without the appropriate data, we're really bad at knowing what the actual median for our own industry is or for our own company is. So we're really bad at judging rewards. And arguably, we're pretty bad at judging effort, too. So transparency really helps with the first piece. that it becomes easier to see what the rewards, what the pay is for different people, and that brings us towards a system where it's easier for employees to maintain that equity and that sense of motivation, or it's easier for employers to correct the record and say, no, this is actually what it is, and this is why this person gets what is paid, etc. In a secrecy condition, you don't have any of that, and so because we're so bad at making these judgments, we're more likely to be demotivated even if the system is actually fair. And this is the big thing that I tell a lot of companies, is if you're, and by all means, if your pay system is not fair, do not go transparent. It's going to be the worst thing you could do. But if you are striving to have a fair and equitable pay system, then you only benefit from transparency. Even if it's not perfect, it will get better in a transparent condition. So there's really not much of a downside if you already have that fair system in place.
That makes a lot of sense. You know, I think kind of what you're getting at, and you mentioned it in your talk, is that if we don't have pay transparency, we tend to assume that we're underpaid. Is that right?
So, yeah, a lot of people feel like that they are underpaid in a secrecy condition. If you don't know what the median salary is, you're more likely to feel like you are below that median. And then, interestingly enough, we're also more likely to make all sorts of assumptions about other people. And some of this is just, you know, basics. We read little signals. Oh, so-and-so has a Rolex, or they drive a BMW. Now, it could be that so-and-so's spouse makes a ton of money, and that's why, right? Or it could be that they're overpaid. We don't know. We don't know the full stories often. So we make all sorts of assumptions, and it can usually, because of the sort of loss aversion idea, usually we end up feeling underpaid when we're not aware of what our salary is and how it compares to the median. And that's obviously a recipe for disaster if you're an employer, or because you think your system is fair and someone else thinks it leads them to be underpaid. The interesting thing, too, is on the flip side of that, open and honest conversations about why someone is paid what they're paid, even if they are underpaid compared to the market rate, can actually lead to an increase in organizational commitment. So, you're underpaid, here's why, we're a small startup, or here's why we're a nonprofit, or what have you. That open, honest conversation can usually decrease an employee's intent to leave, just because now they at least understand why it is what it is, even if they still don't like what it is.
Ooh, I could see that. Especially, you know, say you needed to get some additional training or additional years of experience, I think it would start to make sense, and maybe you could stay committed knowing that you were going in the right direction, or that, you know, as the company grows, your salary will also grow.
Yeah, so one of the largest companies that we profiled in the book, I didn't talk about it much in the talk, that is a private sector company that is pay transparent, is Whole Foods, and they actually list the salary data, but also the performance data for stores and units across the company. And it really came out of the co-CEO, John Mackey's frustrations with different executives coming to him and saying, well, so-and-so is underpaid. And no, here's why he makes that, and here's why he's worth that. And if you start to be worth that, we'll pay you that too. And so sometimes it's a hard pill to swallow, but it is that wake-up call of, like, you need this additional training, or you need to be doing this additional work. But now you at least know how you can get paid more, so you're motivated to go do those things to get paid more.
Mm-hmm. I think that's very true. Do you ever give advice to folks who say we work in an environment that's not transparent, and we suspect that we are, in fact, underpaid? What advice would you give to someone in that scenario in terms of how to work to correct your own, you know, being underpaid?
So I guess it really depends on what you want to do. If you want to get a raise yourself, then my advice is not to stir the pot too much and try and look towards external data. So PayScale is a company that I admire a lot that does a lot of great data on this, as a salary.com, et cetera. Try and figure out what the median is for sort of your area, and then you've got that information to bring up. If you're trying to fix the system, then I would actually start looking into the laws in your state and in your area that protect you. Most employees, but the definition of employee varies a lot, so this is not legal advice. Most employees are protected by federal law. They're protected to be able to share each other's salaries. So you can start asking those questions and try and figure out that information internally. That said, that doesn't cover every single situation. So if you want to change the actual system in your workplace, then I would start first by looking into what laws are specific to your area, and then how you can best start bringing up that conversation in the workplace. Again, that fixes the whole system. If you're just looking for you, there's a lot of internal data that won't create all of that, or excuse me, external data that won't create all of that internal friction that you can pull on to bring into your next salary negotiation.
Those are some really good points. I hadn't really thought about the legal piece, but Speaking of the legal...
It's one of those issues where you're totally, you're protected in most cases, but mm-hmm. proving that you are protected can take 18 months to 2 years and be expensive. So sometimes it's not worth it.
Yeah, I totally agree. Well, so speaking of the legal case or laws, there are a number of places in the U.S. now where you can't, during the application process, the company is not allowed to ask the applicant kind of what their current or previous salaries were. And I'm curious to know sort of what your perspective is on this new outlook on hiring.
Yeah, so I'll be honest, I have mixed feelings about this one. So the rationale behind it is noble. So the problem in a lot of salary negotiations, as I talk about in the talk, is a problem of information asymmetry, which is a situation in any negotiation, and actually most of the research on this was done with used car buying, which is an apt metaphor for salary negotiations, really. You don't know if the car's a lemon or what's going on. There's mm-hmm. an information asymmetry there. The dealer knows more than you do about that specific car, and that creates an inability for the market to operate efficiently. And over time, sort of markets can break down, or there's opportunity for other businesses to come in and provide more information. This is why Carfax is so successful, et cetera, right? So in a salary negotiation, same thing. The more information you have, the more power you have in the negotiation, but most of them are asymmetrical. The company knows what it's willing to offer, and then the company asks the prospective employee, how much did you get paid? And if someone got paid 60 grand in their previous job, but the company has 80 grand, there are very few people that are going to go, well, you're going to love this because we're going to pay you $20,000 more. No, in reality, they're going to go, you know, I think we can hit that number. We might be able to do a bit better. And they're going to offer 65, 70 and save the rest of the money. Mm-hmm. I mean, even well-meaning managers, because often it is you have X amount of budget for all of the salaries that you're responsible for. So you're trying to weight certain things. There's no, I had one manager at one point early in my career who just decided it was his job to fight the HR department and offer the top of range for every single person. But Ooh. Those people are pretty rare. In reality, most people are trying to operate inside of those terms. And so there's a potential that you're going to be worse off. So what's happening state by state, and I lost count, it's more than five now, but it's mm-hmm. growing. It seems like every couple of months I read a new story, is that they're saying, well, we'll make it illegal for employers to ask employees their previous salary, and that'll help reduce the information asymmetry. And that's true. I think we should probably go a bit further. I think it would be beneficial for companies to just say right up front, this is the range that we have to offer to, so you're reducing the asymmetry even more. But the truth is, I've honestly become a bit skeptical of government-led initiatives to do this, you know, to do it through regulation or to do it through passing laws, et cetera, because I would much rather see this be a voluntary movement. I'd much rather see senior leaders of large companies and entrepreneurs realize that there is a huge benefit in morale and in motivation and all sorts of benefits to being a more transparent company and choose to adopt it voluntarily than have to regulate to get there. I'd much rather see this be a voluntary movement, and I think it would move faster if it were a voluntary movement.
Interesting. That's an interesting perspective. I'll be honest, I love not providing my salary history to employers. For me, I've negotiated up my own salary over 50% twice, and once I doubled it. And for me, if the employer had my past data, that would never have happened. But I can see what you mean about it would be nice if companies kind of could make their own rules and choose to move forward in a direction as opposed to sort of being forced to for...
Well, mm-hmm. And the other thing I'll tell you, your experience is awesome. This is also probably why people pay you to be a coach. the truth is your experience is also really rare. So there's some recent survey data from Payscale, which I think is a great company mm-hmm. For doing this research in this regard, that often when females don't list their prior salaries, they take a hit. In other words, they could have gotten more if they listed their salary. And interestingly enough, it's the opposite for males, which is, you know, 100% wrong. There's mm-hmm. there's no moral gray area there. This is straight up wrong. The sort of hidden biases and assumptions are that if a female's listing it, it's because maybe it's a little bit lower and they're trying to go for higher. And if a male's listing it, it may be because he's embarrassed, et cetera. And that's, it's hugely sexist, but you start to see that in when you start surveying tens of thousands of employees, you start to see that gap, even in this idea of should reduce information asymmetry. So again, this is why I would much rather see it be a voluntary movement. There's a story of an old tech company that, you know, got acquired and is probably somehow now answering to Google. But one of the things they used to do is they used to basically refuse to negotiate salary. So they would make the job offer, and then they would say, you know, do you want to come work for us? And then you go, well, what was the salary? And they're like, don't worry about it. We'll come up with something. Once you commit, we'll negotiate something that's worthwhile for both of us. But their whole idea was that, like, if you want to come for the money, then we don't want you. We want you to be committed to us, and then we'll pay you. And they paid well. They paid above market rate, so they knew they could get away with this. But I kind of like that idea. Just let's not even talk about it till we know there's a fit, right?
Yeah, possibly. I mean, I like...
I realize that's the ideal world, not the world we live in, right?
Totally.
Yeah.
I like it when the conversation kind of happens at the end. Like, we've decided that we want to work together, kind of like you're saying, and we're going to find something that works for the both of us. You know how much I'm worth now. I'm willing to go up or down so much based on how much I love your company. And, you know, together we can find sort of a middle ground. I think it's a good idea. But I love your example of buying used cars, because buying cars and going through that negotiation process in itself is really difficult. I don't want to go on a huge tangent, but I will say the last car that I bought it through the internet so that I never had to speak with the salesperson ever. And I hired a mechanic to go and inspect the car in person. So that there was no interaction. It made the negotiation so much easier because it was through email, and I was negotiating against different dealerships until I could sort of get the best possible deal, just because it is such a negative experience trying to go through that car negotiation.
Yeah, and I think that actually speaks to what explains pay scales data. If you think about the average employee, you're only making a couple first job, you know, or first job in that company salary negotiations, right? And those really matter for merit raises and all that. But you only do it 5 or 6 times, maybe in your whole career, maybe a few more. But it's something you want to avoid, and it's something that you're not good at because you're not doing it that often. And so that's why I think we see this refrain from even wanting to talk about it. And it's a hugely important, it's where we are right now. But it's also, you know, it's one of the reasons we need help. It's one of the reasons so many folks come to you, I'm sure, that it's I need help doing this because it makes me uncomfortable. Just like you had a plan for negotiating a used car. I think you've got to go into that negotiation with a plan and with as much data as you can. I look at it from the other employer side, and I go, well, if this is something that's making every single or most of the employees uncomfortable, then maybe we just scrap the whole thing, and maybe we say, here's what the position pays. Do you want to come work with us or not?
Yeah. You know, that's like, if you compare it to cars, that's like the Saturn model used to be when Saturn was still around.
Yeah.
They had no negotiation when you would go onto the car lot. And I bought a car earlier in my life that was a Saturn, which I never wanted to get a Saturn.
You just didn't. You wanted to avoid a salary or a car negotiation that much that you were willing to buy a Saturn. I think that's amazing.
It's true. Well, you know what happened first, and I'm not going to go too far on this point, but I actually was planning to get a Toyota, and I had enough cash to buy it outright. And I went to the dealership, and I looked so young that the sales guy would not take me seriously, and he would not give me a pamphlet or anything about the car. And I left, and I thought, how am I going to buy the Toyota? Because I've got the cash to buy it, but the guy won't even have a conversation, the sales guy. And that's how I ended up with the Saturn, is I walked onto the dealership, and there was somebody there that was polite, and there was no negotiation, and I bought it, and I walked away.
Isn't it amazing what happens when you treat humans like other humans? I know.
That's true. Weird? It's so nuts. It's nuts. I will say one last thing on negotiation, and then I want to really pick your brain about networking, which is very often I hear people say that women don't negotiate. And what I see from coaching is that men and women don't negotiate. I'd love to see some data around that, but...
No, I mean, fundamentally, I agree, and I think that's what explains the pay scale data. They didn't dive into this, so I don't have any wide-scale data for this. Mm-hmm. This is my own sort of reading into the data. I think fundamentally that's exactly what's going on. It's not a women don't, but men do. It's nobody really likes to do it. Nobody wants to go through a used car negotiation. Nobody wants to go through a salary. There's a small percentage of people, we usually call them sociopaths, that are like actively, I love this. I love doing the deal, right? And everybody else wants to avoid it. The problem is what sort of internal gender biases we have that creep up when you're trying to avoid the negotiation. For some reason, the avoidance of the negotiation tends to benefit men more than women. And so that, to me, just goes, all right, well, if that's happening because there's a desire to negotiate that people are refraining from, maybe it's better if we just don't do the negotiation and we pay, this is what the position is worth. Now, this is also, by the way, my sort of grand if I ruled the world. I would encourage a lot of companies to pay a salary based on what the position is worth and then to pay annual bonuses based on performance, not to lump the two together. And so that would make it a lot easier to just say, this is what we've decided the position is worth. This is what we could pay for the position. There's bonuses on top of it, but this is what your base salary is.
Yes, I totally agree. I could not agree more. Well, I want to switch over and talk to you a little bit about networking, because you have a new book coming out, Friend of a Friend, and you focus on how to really grow our professional networks. And I'd love for you just to talk a little bit about why it's so important that we do grow our professional networks in terms of growing our career.
Yeah, so, I mean, there's all sorts of cliche phrases here that we could go into, right? Your network is your net worth and all of those sort of things. And for the most part, they're true. What the term that we sociologists use is social capital. And social capital refers to, through a community, just how tight the bonds are or how loose the bonds are creates sort of capital and opportunities inside a community. But it also happens individually, that the extent to which you have developed social capital, a powerful, diverse, and broad network that can be tapped when you need help, that's a form of capital just like financial capital, just like human capital, you know, knowledge, skills, and abilities. But it's also a form of capital that a lot of us sort of tend to avoid, right? I mean, you know, either we avoid it because we say, oh, well, I'm an introvert, so I don't have to necessarily do this, it makes me uncomfortable, et cetera. Or, truthfully, we avoid it because we go, oh, I'm an extrovert, I love doing this, and then we do it terribly. So in both cases, I think there's a need to be a little bit more deliberate, but also a little bit more understanding about how networks work so we can understand how that affects our social capital, so that translates into a successful and hopefully a profitable career.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Gosh, I feel like I could ask you so many questions just based on your answer to this one. But I noticed in some of your materials, you talk about the fact that you know, that there's proof that networking really works. You say specifically that it's based on the science of human behavior. And I was wondering if you can give us any examples to really stick in our minds about, you know, why networking is in fact so important. Like, what kind of data exists to back this up?
Yeah, so, I mean, one of my favorite studies, because it was, conducted well with a control group and all of that sort of thing, is a study conducted by Ronald Burt on this idea of social capital. And basically what they did was they took groups of executives, several hundred people, divided them into two groups. They gave some of them training on here's how networks work, here's how to develop social capital, here's how to build rapport, here's how to do, you know, all of that sort of training that we do around what does it take to meet new people. And the other group, they didn't. And then they followed them around for several years and found that the people who had been trained on seeing social capital and acting accordingly were more likely to get promotions, more likely to get raises, just because they sort of understood it. Another study I love on this, because I think it's just funny, it's sort of a two-part study. It's based on survey data, so not a control group, but it showed that essentially we, almost all of us, hate this networking feeling, right? We hate feeling like that sleazy weirdo pushing business cards into people's hands, et cetera. But the truth is that the people who either like it a bit more than others or swallow that awkward feeling and do it anyway do in fact tend to have this was of lawyers, but do in fact tend to bill more hours and have a more broad client base, etc. So it definitely helps, even though it makes us uncomfortable. In fact, in a follow-up study by the same group of people, they showed that networking does in fact lead to subconscious thoughts of wanting to get clean, which is another way of saying that networking makes us feel dirty.
Ooh.
But yet it's still something that's sort of important to do. I think the dirty comes from this idea that a lot of us are trying to follow advice. There's a lot of networking books out there, but most of them are built off of advice from one person. And then we go to the event and we feel like, oh, I feel so inauthentic. Well, duh, you're applying someone else's advice. You're not being you, you're being them. So of course you're going to feel inauthentic and sleazy, right? So we take a little bit different approach. The goal here was just to say, here is what network science can teach us about how humans connect and interact. And then once you know that, you can begin to develop the strategy that works best for you.
Yeah, I think you're right. You know, I think another reason people might feel, quote, dirty when they go to a networking event is sometimes we wait to go until we need something. Like, we wait to go until we need a job, we need a favor. And I think it's a lot, it doesn't feel good to go and just be looking to get something from other people versus when you're networking because you're trying to build relationships over time. I think it's a really different experience.
No, exactly right. And in fact, in that study that I'm referring to, they had two different types of people. They had folks that were asked to recall times when they had to do professional networking, so reaching out to make a professional connection. And then they had a different group of people think about times where they were just made a new friend, reached out to make a personal connection. And it was the professional ones that felt dirty. The other ones were sort of unaffected, right? But I think you're exactly right. And you know, this is true to the principles of social capital. Social capital is just, it's just like investing. It's something you build over time. You can't just go, oh, well, suddenly I need money, so let me go to my 401k. Oh, I've been putting nothing in it for 10 years, so there's nothing here to withdraw. It's the same with social capital. You build it up little by little over time so that you can make those withdrawals. You don't just go, oh, no, now I'm unemployed, I need a new job opportunity, and so now I have to start building social capital.
Mm-hmm. That's a really good way to explain it. I mean, that's perfect. You definitely can't withdraw something if you haven't been depositing into it.
Exactly.
There's another thing I want to ask you about, because I remember the very first time I heard this term. It was around 2004, and I remember because a professor mentioned it to me. They talked about a super connector, and I know it's something that you talk about, so if we have never heard this term before, what in the world does it mean?
It's one of my favorite terms from the book, and one of the reasons is that it's actually a very cloudy term, right? So you have in electrical engineering, there's actually a term for a superconnector or a superconductor. That's not what we're talking about. Then there's also sort of Keith Ferrazzi started using the term in the early 2000s to refer to people who have large connections of other people. And that's a little bit more true. But when I use the term, I'm using it in a network science approach, which is that, you know, if you think about a human network, every person in network science lingo would be referred to as a node. And a network is a connection of nodes and linkages. And some nodes have more linkages than others. We tend to think about, if we wanted to think about how people know people, we tend to think about it like there's got to be an average somewhere, right? Malcolm Gladwell explored the idea of Dunbar's number of 150, right? So we think, oh, maybe we congregate around 150. Some people might have more, some people might have less, but it's an average. The truth is that most networks, including human networks, actually follow a power law, an 80-20 principle, when it comes to how many connections you have. So superconnectors really are those people that have not just an above average, but an exponentially above average connection of people. And a couple different things happen when you sort of reach that super connector status. So, I mean, first, your social capital is you've got a pretty decent investment fund, if we're using that as the analogy. The other thing that happens is that the network sort of disproportionately is more likely to serve you new connections. So you work hard and you build up social capital, you build up lots of different network connections, and then those network connections start referring new people to you, and your network kind of grows on autopilot. And this is why I want to encourage everybody to sort of move up the curve. You might not ever be able to go from, you know, oh, I only know about 100 people to suddenly I know 4,000 people and I'm this huge super connector. But as you move up that curve, as you move up that power law, it becomes more likely that new connections and new opportunities are going to come to you rather than you having deliberately to go to them. I think this is really good news, especially for the people that are like, oh, I don't like networking, I don't like meeting new people, et cetera, is that, yeah, it's hard work, and it might make you feel a bit uncomfortable at first, but it gets easier over time as you're on the path to becoming a super connector.
Absolutely. I think you're totally right. And like you said, the more connected that you are, the more that opportunities start to come to you. I mean, that's sometimes where job opportunities even show up kind of at your doorstep, as opposed to going out and having to really search for them in the same way.
Yeah, exactly right. And I think that's, we all know that person. And then for some reason, we all think we've got to be the sleazy weirdo pushing business cards in everybody's hands to be that person. Mm-hmm. No, you don't. It takes time, and it builds over time as you get to moving up the power law and increasing your number of connections. And you know, the best way to do that, to be honest with you, is to start practicing making connections and serving the network by making introductions and connecting two different people to each other. Start acting like a super connector even before you are one. And then you begin to sort of send this message that this, it, not only by introducing people are you adding value to the network, but you're also sending this message that this person is open to meeting new people, which makes it more likely that you're going to get those referrals.
Mm-hmm. And I love the word practice, because when we don't put so much emphasis on doing everything perfectly every time, I think it becomes so much easier. Well, when you actually have a chapter in your book called Skip Mixers and Share Activities Instead. And I have to say, I really loved seeing this, because I'm the kind of person that I tend to do really crazy things to meet new people. Years ago, I think I went salsa dancing in Stockholm, Sweden, in order to meet local people from Sweden, because there's no tourists who are doing that. And I'm just curious, when you suggest this, you know, skip the mixers and do activities instead, what sorts of things are you thinking of? Like, what should we be looking for?
Yeah, so, I mean, the first thing is, if you're made uncomfortable by networking events, I have good news for you. You never have to go to one ever again, right? because the research is really quite clear on this, that when we, as humans, introvert or extrovert, doesn't matter, when we go to these type of events where the whole point of the event is to meet new people, it's not to learn something new, it's not to share an activity, et cetera, it's just to meet new people, then what takes over is our sort of internal drive to hang out with people we already know, or to talk longer to people that are more similar to us, and you end up not making the level of new or diverse connections that you hoped you would. This is why almost everyone leaves a networking event thinking, oh, that I really didn't get out of that what I thought I was going to get out of it. It's not you, it's the meeting. Where shared activities come in is the research is also really clear that when you have an event, an activity, whether it's a nonprofit, whether it's a hobby, a sports league, salsa dancing, you know, whatever it is, where the goal is to participate in an activity, not to meet new people, you end up meeting new people by accident. And the interesting thing is you end up meeting more diverse people, because it's more about who is doing this activity with you than who are you supposed to meet.
Mm-hmm.
And so you build deeper and more diverse connections faster through this sort of quirk of not trying to make meeting new people the goal. And again, you also defeat that sort of pull of homophily, to use a fancy sociology word, where you end up meeting more diverse people. Which I think is really, really useful. You know, if you're living in Sweden as an expat, yes, you got to go to the salsa dancing lesson. You can't go to the expat bar and expect to meet lots of locals. It's just
right.
Not going to happen. You've got to break out and go somewhere else. But you also don't want to be that one dropping in on a meeting on a networking event in Sweden, because now you're just that odd sort of oddball out, right? So if you go to somewhere where everyone has agreed the goal is to do this, to learn salsa dancing, you end up doing all that other stuff by accident, and in fact, you end up doing it by accident more effectively.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You know, for folks who are in sort of marketing and technology, another thing I really have enjoyed participating in is what they call hackathons, where you go for a weekend and you work on different programming projects together, because it's another situation where you kind of have a shared goal, but you get to spend a lot of time with new people, and I find that it develops some really great connections really quickly.
Yeah, no, that's a great one. So the rules are basically it has to draw diverse people. There has to be a shared goal that's above and beyond meeting those new people. And there has to be stakes. There has to be skin in the game. There has to be an ability you can lose, right?
Mm-hmm.
Not necessarily, you can't necessarily lose at salsa dancing, but you can be the least best one, right? But hackathons are a great example. You're sort of all working on something, but it's your team, and there are other teams. And, you know, it's done in a friendly environment where it's not like, you know, we lose and everybody walks away crying. But there is definitely a winner. There is definitely sort of a best team. And that, I think, is really, really useful for bonding people together faster.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. Well, so I'm curious, once we've made these connections, we've met these people, whether it's at a hackathon or wherever else, how do we actually grow them? Like, how can we make those connections deeper connections over time?
So one of the worst things that we do as humans is we have a tendency to sort people into buckets. Right, we have the work bucket, the salsa dancing bucket. Right, we have the maybe our, you know, if you have children, we have the who do I know who my kids go to school with their kids. Right, we might have the church or the temple bucket. Right, we tend to use the context where we first met someone as the definition for how we're supposed to interact with that person. And this flies in the face of a lot of network science research in something called multiplexity. Multiplexity basically just means that there are uniplex ties, which are that one work context or one family context for connecting to someone. And multiplex ties are ones where there are multiple different contexts in which you interact with someone. So you work together, but your kids also go to school together, and you both love that new TV show, right? Whatever it is, it doesn't matter. The point is, the more context you have to have conversations in and the more types of linkages you have to that same person, the stronger connection you build, and the stronger connection you build faster. So it really, I think, building out and strengthening these connections over time, one of the really important things to do is try and take it out of that original context and get to know them more. And, you know, we know this is true because we would want people to know every the whole us, the whole facet of us, not just this sort of one context. And, you know, that the same thing goes the other way. We ought to be seeking that. Now, that said, that's if we know that we want to build a deeper relationship with that person over time. The other thing we have to think about is how broad our network is, so building out new additional connections over time. And that really comes from figuring out who are we going to give permission to be weak ties to, give permission to be, oh, I check in with you every couple of months, and we're both happy with sort of that arrangement, and there isn't pressure to do that, because those people are also hugely important to your network as well.
These are some great tips. Well, David, this has been excellent. If we're listening today and we'd like to learn more about you or get a copy of your book, where can we go?
So probably the best place to go is davidburkus.com, B-U-R-K-U-S. I have a really weird last name, and it means the domain names are always open, which is great. but there's a ton of, you can find out more about the book. By all means, I hope you click over to your retailer of choice and buy it in triplicate. But the truth is, there's a ton of resources on that website about the ideas in the book, so you can start to learn more and go a bit deeper. Even if you never check out the book, I hope you just benefit from those as well.
Awesome. Well, thank you, David. This has been excellent.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me.
And thanks, everyone, for listening. Thanks to those of you who sent me questions. You can send me your questions to angela@copelandcoaching.com. You can also send me questions via Twitter. I'm @CopelandCoach. And on Facebook, I'm Copeland Coaching. Don't forget to help me out. Subscribe on Apple Podcasts and leave me a review.
Thank you for listening to the Copeland Coaching Podcast today with your host, Angela Copeland. Tune in next time to get more great tips on turning your job search into a slam dunk.